It's incredibly important, not only from a career standpoint, but from, you know, just a personal standpoint. I mean, I actually met my wife at Superstars. For instance, on God of Neverland, which just came out this year from Harper Voyager, I got quotes from Brandon Sanderson, David Farland, Kevin J. Anderson. So, you know, these are things I wouldn't have been able to get had it not been for those connections I've been making for the past, you know, 12 years now. What really helped me is when I figured out that it was okay if your first draft was bad. So that's a big piece of advice that I always give to writers who are starting out is it's okay if your first draft is bad. That's what it's for.
Welcome to the Stark Reflections on Writing and Publishing podcast. There has never been a better time for writers. More information, options, and opportunities are available to you, but navigating these requires insight. Join Mark Leslie Lefebvre as he draws upon more than a quarter century of experience as a writer, a bookseller, and a trusted book industry consultant to explore and reflect on the writing and publishing landscape to help you make informed choices on your writer journey.
Hello, Reflectives, and welcome to episode 269 of the Stark Reflections podcast. This is your host, Mark Leslie Lefebvre. In today's episode, I have an interview with Gama Ray Martinez. Gama lives near Salt Lake City, Utah, with his wife and kids, and he moved there solely because he likes mountains. He collects weapons in case he ever needs to supply a medieval battalion, and he greatly resents when work or other real-life things get in the way of writing. He secretly hopes to one day slay a dragon in single combat, and he does not believe in letting pesky little things like reality stand in the way of dreams. And we kind of talk about that because the reality and the dreams mesh in a beautiful way, not just in Gama's writing, but in his experience as a writer. And that's coming up later in this episode. First, let's hear a word about this episode's sponsor. This episode is sponsored by Findaway Voices. Findaway Voices is an audiobook platform that is for distribution to a global market. It's also a platform you can use to create your audiobooks. If you are looking for a professional narrator, there's two different ways to get one. You can use a project manager in a very hands-on approach where you put up an RFP and then a professional from Findaway Voices will find and narrow down between 5 and 10 narrators that they think would be perfect for your project. Or with Marketplace, there's a DIY option now available. Or if you want to, like me, if you do have the audio that you either purchased from a professional narrator, or if you've had the equipment and inclination and time and sweat and blood and tears to do it yourself, you can upload your audiobook to Findaway Voices. And speaking of which, I just recently uploaded Lover's Moon by Mark Leslie and Julie Strauss as read by the authors. And I have that version, which has been released as a free podcast with musical introduction, etc. for every episode, rolling out over 23 weeks or so. It's we've got another 5 weeks to go. But because I got all the audio ready, yeah, for a change, I'm ahead of myself. I actually recently just produced it and produced the files following the online specifications from Findaway Voices. And on Thursday, September 15th, 2022, I uploaded the final files and I submitted them for approval. And within 24 hours, they were approved, which means it's going to be distributed soon. Now, this particular version is the read by the author's version, so it's going to be less expensive. I'm actually setting a retail price of $4.99 US. There actually is a release price because you have that option with Findaway Voices. I've got a special, you know, for the first 2 weeks of release. It's going to be ridiculously inexpensive, $1. But then it goes up to $5. And with the professionally narrated version from Scott and Sarah, who are doing the voices as opposed to Julie and I, that one's going to be full price. Because with audio, an audiobook is not just an audiobook, but there's multiple types and styles and formats of audiobook. This particular audiobook is read by the authors. The other one will be professionally narrated. But in both cases, the audio is going to be me reading Michael's point of view, Julie reading Gail's point of view, and the dialogue for each character read by each of us, and the same thing will be true in the Scott and Sarah, the professionally narrated version. That's sort of a combination of a narrator or a dual narrator, but also a combination of the dialogue as well, which I find is a great style. But there can be single narrated versions, etc. And that's the fantastic thing about audio, is audio is not just one book. Audio is different formats, different experiences, because different listeners, different readers want to experience things differently. Some people want ebooks, some people want print, some people want large print, some people want paperback, hardcover, and different versions of audio. And that's the great thing about working with Findaway, is you can find a way to do it your way. You can do it multiple ways. You're not limited. There's lots of choice. There's lots of options for distribution, for setting different prices. You can have it all with Findaway. And if you want to see how you can leverage Findaway Voices as an author, you can check them out over at starkreflections.ca/findaway. Now, as mentioned in episode 268, I am going to be away. I'm actually away this week as you're listening to this. If you're listening to this the week of September 19th through 23rd, this episode is geared to be published on September 23rd, 2022. So I'm pre-recording this before I head to NINC, to Novelist NINC. So I'm not going to give a personal update, although I did sneak a little bit of one into the ad read for Findaway Voices. But I'm not doing more of a personal update, and I'm not going to go through comments. I did see some great comments. Thank you guys so much for leaving them. You can leave them over at starkreflections.ca for any episode, or you can at me on Twitter. I am at Mark Leslie, and I'll get caught up on those comments in the coming weeks. But right now, sit back and relax, because you're going to hear me and Gama Ray Martinez in a conversation about his writing journey in both traditional publishing and indie publishing. Gama, welcome to the Stark Reflections podcast.
Thank you, Mark.
So this is weird because normally, I mean, I see you online because we're Facebook friends, and I see what you and Melissa and the family are up to, but I usually only see you once a year. I see you often in February in Colorado. Yeah, uh-huh. So cool that we get to hang out now virtually.
Yeah, definitely.
So we're going to be talking about, you got a forthcoming book that just came up for pre-order. But before we get into that, I just want to talk about your background as a writer. Is that something you always wanted to do?
Yeah, pretty much always. I remember as a kid getting in trouble because I was supposed to write like a descriptive essay, and I wrote a story about the picture that I was given. So,
oh, really? So you actually just went right into the imagination.
Yeah.
and was it always like fantasy, fantastical worlds?
Yeah, for the most part. Yeah, definitely.
Okay. What was your first, when you were first starting out, with like first story that you sold, or what was the first thing that got out there?
The first thing that got out there is, when David Farland was coming out with his Nightingale series, he did a contest for people to write stories set in that universe. And that ended up getting second place in that.
Whoa.
And I got one of my stories. It was like an Arthurian story set in that universe, published alongside one of his. So I think that was the first one that got out there.
Your first story was published by, like, in a David Farland anthology with him as the judge, probably in one of his universes. Besides, talk about starting at the top. Like, that's amazing. Wow. So that was cool. So had you met Dave through Superstars? Is that where you first met him, or where was it?
Yeah, I've met Dave through Superstars, and then I went to a number of his workshops as well.
Okay. And so he was very much an editorial writing craft mentor to you as well?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah.
Cool. And then so I know I'm excited to talk about the forthcoming book that we have up for pre-order, but let's talk a little bit about your writing and publishing history. So your first short story, bam. Right there, Dave Farland's universe, right beside Dave Farland. Where did you go from there? What was the path of your career?
It's kind of funny. So Superstar started doing an anthology.
Okay.
And the first one was Purple Unicorns. So James Owen was doing a cover, and as a joke, he put up this meme he had found. It was like the Unitato, half unicorn, half potato.
Okay.
And I was like, I could do that. So I wrote a short story about a unicorn, a purple unicorn, who had been turned into a potato. And
Oh my God.
Got into their anthology.
So you were inspired by that. I mean, because this is a very busy cover, as James often has all these elements in.
Yeah.
Oh my God, that's hilarious. So, and that was Tracy was the editor, or Lisa was the editor for that.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Yeah.
And did Lisa pick up on the fact that you had done it from the cover, or did that come afterwards?
Oh no. So that was just like a joke cover he had posted. That wasn't the real one.
Oh, okay. That was like an early. Okay.
Like just a joke. And I was like, you know, I can do a Unitato. And so that, yeah, Lisa later told me that she finished reading and was like laughing because it was like, it's a good story. And it's,
that's funny. What, for anyone who's not listening, you and I both know the background of the purple unicorn, but where did that come from, the concept of the purple unicorn story?
So Kevin J. Anderson had this speech that he used to give. He was like, if you are going to write a story, you write the best story you can, even if something completely ridiculous, even if it's like a purple unicorn story. And if you can't stand to write a purple unicorn story, don't agree to be in a purple unicorn anthology. And so Lisa Mangum heard him give this talk and got in touch with him, basically saying, so do we want to do this purple unicorn thing? And that's...
And see how people just attack it to create some really brilliant stories on that theme. And that was the first of multiple anthologies that she's edited for fundraiser, actually, for Superstars, which is amazing. So how important is that kind of community to you? You know, like getting to interact with people like Dave Farland, James Owen, you know, Lisa, Kevin, all those folks.
Oh, it's incredibly important, not only from a career standpoint, but from, you know, just a personal standpoint. I mean, I actually met my wife at Superstars, so it's...
Of course. very important element.
Yeah. But like, for instance, on my on God of Neverland, which just came out this year from Harper Voyager, I got quotes from Brandon Sanderson, David Farland, Kevin J. Anderson. So, you know, these are things I wouldn't have been able to get had it not been for those connections I've been making for the past, you know, 12 years now.
Oh, man. And I have to say, God of Neverland was absolutely amazing. I'll be honest with you. I'd never really been all that interested in returning to Barry's, you know, the Peter Pan universe. But oh, my God, Michael grown up. You know, I just love the relationships that the siblings have as adults and then going back. Let's talk a little bit about the inspiration for God of Neverland. Where did that come from for you?
A number of years ago, I decided I would go through a bunch of, you know, old classic stories. So I read like the Jungle Book, Gulliver's Travels, and then I got to Peter Pan and I got to the epilogue, and it talks about what happened to all of the lost boys and how most of them forgot, and how Wendy believed longer than any of, well, Michael believed longer than any of them except for Wendy, but he eventually grew up and became a train engineer. And, you know, I was like, okay, you know what? There's more story there. And, you know, there was, you know, little blurbs in Peter Pan, like each chapter starts with a chapter heading, and it talks about how, you know, you can't really define in Neverland, you know, like there are all sorts of things, like there's this little old lady that lives in a swamp with a crooked nose, and then she became like a witch in my story. So, you know, just all these little details that, you know, just came together.
So that must have been a lot of fun to put together. When you were writing it, did you already have the contract secured with the publisher, or was it you were writing it because you wanted to and then you pitched it later?
I was writing it because I wanted to. This is a story I wanted to tell, but this was the first one I had really done with the intention of pitching to the big publishers.
Okay. Because you had we kind of skipped that first story published, second story published. I'm curious to know when you went into longer form, or did you do short stories for a while? How did that evolve?
So I got into the longer one. So I got this idea for a trilogy, and this was the first thing I was actually out with a micro publisher at the time. I've since re-released it as a omnibus, but it was like this trilogy of a guy who went from story to story. So he started off in Greek mythology. He took the idea of, he found out that Hera's golden apples had become poisonous. He took the idea of a poison apple to cross into Snow White. He did a bunch of stuff there and went to the ancestral homeland of the Seven Dwarfs, which was in Norse mythology. And that was like my first thing that I put out there. That was called The Oracles of Carnoogie. And I mean, honest, looking at it now, it's a little rough because, you know, it was my first thing out there.
Right. But it did well from what I saw. Like, you were doing the Comic Cons and you were selling those.
Yeah. I did that one. And then I did the next series that came was started with the book Shadow Guard. And that one is the one that actually did really well.
That's the one that okay. So that's right. That was your the sophomore. So, and then you pitched. Where did you pitch? Did you pitch in person? Did you pitch? Was it to an agent, to an editor at Tor? How did you do that?
Yeah, actually, so Dave Pomerico, who was the editor, was a guest at Superstars one year.
You didn't pitch it at Superstars, did you?
Yeah, I did, actually. Yeah.
No, get out of here, really.
Yeah, and so it was funny. I was talking to someone later, and they were like, "Yeah, people were kind of upset because like David didn't request for anybody." I'm like, "He requested for me," and so he actually didn't buy it at first. He recommended an agent, and then we worked through some of the details on it.
Oh wow! So how long was that process then?
Let me see. It was probably about six. Well, okay, probably about. So I pitched it in February, and then it got bought in, I'm going to say maybe a year and a half later, I think.
Year and a half later. Wow. That's a lot of patience. Story's been with you for a while then, huh?
Yeah. I actually remember I got the call that it had been bought the week before I got married.
With the two awesome things happening at once. That's
so I actually had special permission from my wife to respond to any writing related emails that happened on our honeymoon. So
fair enough. Yeah. It's just kind of like she knew how much that meant to you too. But she's always been an avid supporter of your writing too.
Definitely.
So
yeah.
That is good. That is fantastic. So I remember you bringing me an ARC, an advanced reader's copy I got in February, earlier this year, 2022, Superstars. And I was so excited to get that copy. And then I put the copy on my shelf, of course. And then I went and got the audiobook because I'm a slow reader.
Yeah.
And, oh my God, the audiobook was amazing too. It was just, it was fantastic. It was so well done. It was a success. Mm-hmm. Obviously, it's done really, really well. Were there nominations, awards? Didn't I see something?
Yeah, it won I think it was an earphones award from I don't remember the magazine, like Audio Mag or Audible Magazine or something like that.
I thought I saw an audio award for it. And I thought, well, because it was, I mean, it's an amazing novel, but it was so well read. So well read. So so you couldn't just stop there. I mean, obviously you created this universe and there is a sense in the novel that there's so much more. Mm-hmm. So you've got book two up for pre-order now, don't you?
Yeah.
So tell me about it.
So that is Queens of Wonderland. Okay. As you can probably tell, it's set in Wonderland. Essentially, they discover that an evil force from Neverland that they were able to chase out has now fled into Wonderland.
Okay.
And so they're going after it. And, you know, I pull in, like, you find out that, like, the original Alice was one of the leaders of their organization.
Oh, wow.
And
okay. So wait a minute. You're taking... like you did in those stories in the first series of novels, you're taking multiple different universes are all public domain, obviously. how fun is that? And is that something you had imagined initially, or was it only sometime after the first one was finished, you know, all those years ago?
Initially, I was on the fence whether this would be like a Neverland series or whether it would go into other universes. And once the book was bought by Harper Voyager, I was talking to the editor about it, and he wanted to go with different worlds. So, I mean, that's the direction we're going. So.
Wow, I love that. I love that. So you go from Neverland to Wonderland, and then I'm, of course, you probably can't talk about it yet, but I'm so curious to see where you go next. And I love that you guys, you and Dave, were talking about this as a, you know, do I stick it in Neverland only and it's just this universe, or can we have a lot of fun with this? Can we explore the multiverses? Mm-hmm. that is great. We'll call it the Gama multiverses. The GamaVerse.
Yeah, that works. Yeah, totally.
So let's go back to that. So you had two different series, fantasy series. You've got this series now with Harper Voyager. What does your writing life look like now in terms of how much time do you spend writing? How much time is working on traditional publishing? How much time is on indie publishing? Do you have a sort of a balance in those things?
With most projects, I am not completely sure if I wanted to go indie or if I wanted to go traditional. I do have the agreement with my agent that I can decide any project is indie and just go with it.
Okay. All right.
Yeah. Right now, he's currently looking at a fairy book that I wrote. It was, I had my stepdaughter ask me, can you write a fairy princess book? And I was like, absolutely I can.
So, for you? Of course.
Yeah. So that's with my agent right now. And then I'm working on another one that I am really excited about that you'll hopefully hear more about later this year.
Maybe February.
that's the hope, because I've been talking to some other people about this, and it's like, yeah, you know what? That is a fantastically marketable idea, and it's right in my strength of, right in my area of strength in writing. So I think that'll do really well.
Oh, fantastic. Well, I love the idea that you have that flexibility now. So it's kind of like your agent can take a look at it. Yes, there may be a market for this, and if not, you know what you're doing when it comes to, you know, DIY as well. So you have the best of both worlds there too. Uh-huh. Cool. So what, when is the Queens of Wonderland coming out?
That is April of next year.
So, oh really? So the pre-order's up now, and it's obviously coming out a year after God of Neverland. Wow. Okay, cool. And I'm assuming that there's going to be a similar cast of characters. So there's continuity and
so the main trio is the one that goes from Neverland to Wonderland, and then you know, you have all the Wonderland characters in there as well. So
that is going to be so much fun. See, I wonder, do you when I was thinking of Wonderland, I was thinking about the Tom Petty video, which was a Don't Come Around Here No More. And there's a lot of Alice in Wonderland visuals for that. It made me wonder, do you listen to music when you write?
Not generally. I usually actually have something on the TV, something that I've seen like a million times that I don't necessarily have to pay attention to because I know what's going on. But like for God of Neverland, I frequently had some of the Pirates of the Caribbean going on in the background.
Oh, really? Okay. So, you've seen the series, the movies multiple times. So you just have them playing in the background. What is that background? What does that do for you, having that background?
It helps me get in the right frame of mind. You know, like Peter Pan obviously has a lot to do with pirates. So hence I do that. And then with Queens of Wonderland, I was watching just completely random stuff, since by definition, Wonderland is just insanity.
Yeah.
So
that's true. Uh-huh. very trippy kind of world. Wow. Okay, that's fascinating. And that's just like in the background, and you're hearing it while you're working on something. Uh-huh. Okay. Oh, that's kind of fascinating. So no, you don't write in quiet then?
No.
Is it handwritten? Is it on a typewriter? Is it on a computer?
It's on a laptop. And actually, when I say I don't write in quiet, that's not entirely true. If I get like really, really into a scene, I would just like shut everything off and just hyper focus on that. But for the most part, it's with the TV in the background.
It's now, are you doing that, you know, sitting with the family, or are you doing it in isolation?
No, in isolation. I convinced my wife to let me get a TV for my office specifically for that reason.
And really?
It's totally tax deductible. I use it for writing.
That's fascinating. That makes sense. If it works, it works, right?
Yeah.
Are you still writing short fiction now that you've done a lot of novels?
Every once in a while. I know Kevin J. Anderson does his program at Western Colorado University, and I've gotten in a couple of his anthologies there. Right. I'm actually working on one for his next anthology, so hopefully that'll get in. But just
announced the announced the mermaids one. Yeah. Well, it's funny. I was in the hallway outside his classroom when they were discussing it, And I was doing some draft to digital work, but I was just sitting and I kept listening and going, "Ooh, this is what they're gonna do. Ooh, this is what they're gonna do." It's kind of fun watching them come up with the concepts for an anthology.
So, yeah.
Okay. Cool. Yeah. And you've been in one or two of them now.
Two of them. Yeah. Yeah. So I was in the Unmasked and I was in the Reflections one.
Oh, very cool. Very cool. Love that. Cool. So do you ever like you write speculative fiction, you write fantastical worlds. What other writing have you done or have you explored other genres?
I've toyed with some horror short stories and a couple of sci-fi ones. I actually did one series that's like a mix of science fiction and fantasy where they're just like elves in space.
Oh, okay. Alrighty.
Okay. But for the most part, I do stay in the fantastical, I'll dabble in short stories, but other than that.
Okay. All right, cool. So I want to go back now. So there's probably people listening to this that are thinking, oh my God, he's got himself an agent. He's got two books with, you know, one of the world's largest publishers. He's got his own DIY books that are out there and doing well. What sort of advice would you give to beginning writers who are just getting started and haven't even sold that first short story?
Don't get super attached to any one piece of work. Recently clearing out old computer files, I came upon the first thing I had ever submitted to Tor, and okay. I was like, oh my goodness, this is terrible.
What was it? Was it a short story? Was it a novel?
It was a novel, but it was really bad. It was far too wordy. It was just not well plotted out. And it's, you know, you're going to have that stage where in order to get good at something, you generally have to start off by being bad at it. And you just have to be able to work through that to just continue to improve and to not get so caught up in any one work that you're so hyper-focused on that, because it might not be as good as you can do after, you know, a couple of years of practice.
So continuing, keeping at it, practicing, yeah, getting better. What's one of your favorite writing craft tips? Something that you've found that's really benefited yourself and your own craft?
What really helped me is when I figured out that it was okay if your first draft was bad.
Okay.
You know, a lot of people get so hung up on trying to, you know, craft this perfect chapter and they're going through it. And, you know, sometimes you just got to write through it and you go back and fix it. That's actually one of my favorite quotes when Kevin J. Anderson has talked about this. I don't remember if it was Larry Niven or Jerry Pornell. They were asked what to do about writer's block. And he goes, the way you get past writer's block is you write. You just keep writing and you write until it's done. And then someone said, but what if it's not good? It was like, then you go back and fix it.
Because you can't fix it if it's not there, right?
Yeah, yeah. So that's a big piece of advice that I always give to writers who are starting out is it's okay if your first draft is bad. That's what it's for.
Okay, that's kind of cool. Yeah. So how do you approach that then? You take the first draft, you then put it aside for a bit, or do you attack it right away for second draft?
Yeah, I generally try to put it aside for like 2 to 4 weeks before I come back to just to get some distance from it so that I'm not just too attached to it, because, you know, mm-hmm. I always know what I meant.
Yeah.
But that's not necessarily true for anyone else.
Okay.
Yeah.
How do you know when you're writing, how do you know that it's going to be a novel, a series of novels, a short story? Do you know when you're starting, or does that, I mean, obviously you write, if you're writing for a market, like an anthology, you know, it's got to be a short story, but how do you, like, at what point do you get to a point where you go, oh no, this has got to be something bigger?
I don't know that it has happened that way. I haven't. When I wrote Shadow Guard, for instance, I didn't know that it was a series at first.
Really? Okay.
And then after I was done, I decided there was a lot more places it could go. So I expanded it into a series. But yeah, I don't always, sometimes in the planning of it, I'll decide if it's a novel or a short story, because I try to figure out just how much story there is there to tell.
Does that mean that you outline then? Do you actually write an outline before you write the story or the novel, or just outline the larger pieces?
I will outline, but I don't start that until I know if it's a story or a novel, just because it's a different process for that.
Right.
But yeah, I have an outline that's generally, it's actually a lot more exact than some people's. I shoot for about one plot point per 1,000 words. So I'm just outlining that out. And okay, with the first act needs to end about a quarter of the way through. So I use that as a very, very rough guideline.
Okay. And I see you've got a whiteboard. You're in your home office, right?
Yes, I am.
Okay. So I see the whiteboard there. Is that something that you use? Like, do you throw ideas up there when you're in the middle of a project, or what is it for, those temporary things you're putting up there?
So I actually work a day job too. So this is just where I sort of plot out my software design stuff that I do by day.
Okay. So, and you work from home too, right?
Yeah. Yeah. Just ever since COVID, this job, I pretty much always work from home, but I just decorate my office with a bunch of stuff that's inspirational. Like, here, hold on. Like, I have this tapestry over there, and then I have,
oh my god, that's gorgeous. Oh, and then the family. That's awesome.
Yeah. And then I started 3D printing. So I have, printer spool. So, yep. Oh, and there are my medals from a marathon that I did. So,
oh my god, that's quite a few medals, yeah. Actually.
Yeah.
So do you do long distance running then, like all marathons, half marathons, stuff like that?
Yeah, I have a goal to do a half marathon in every state, but this particular thing, you can tell, I don't know if you can tell, but it's a Dopey.
Oh yes, Disney.
Yeah, so Disney World has this Dopey challenge. It's in Disney World every January, and it's on consecutive days. You do a 5K, a 10K, a half marathon, then a marathon.
Oh my god! And you've done those all in a row?
Yeah, I did it this year. Yeah.
Wow, that must be exhausting.
Yeah, I mean, it's not the hardest race I've ever done, but it's pretty close.
So you do a 5K, a 10K.
Uh-huh, then a half marathon, half, and a marathon.
And then a marathon. Because you see, after doing the half, I wouldn't be able to, like, I'd be done, right?
Well, I basically walked the entire half, so.
Oh, really?
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Yeah.
So it's not like a Boston qualifier or something.
No. Well, if I'm doing that, I'm not going for time. I'm going to finish, so.
You just want to get her done. Yeah, yeah. Okay, that's fair enough. It's like, hey, I got time. I can get this done. Good stuff. Wow. Yeah. We're recording this on the weekend of Dragon Con, and you've gone to Dragon Con in the past, haven't you? Or
yeah, I've been once. Yeah.
Uh-huh. Yeah. And have you been on tour with this new book from Harper? Have you been to a few events with it?
Yeah. Most recently I was in Hartford for Kineticon, and then I'm doing a Salt Lake Fanex in a few weeks.
Cool. Awesome. And and pretty close to home then. That's nice.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so you don't have to be away from the family.
Yeah. Yeah. The last couple of conventions I went to, they were all on like the East Coast. So I would end up getting back home like at midnight, just because that's how the time works out. So.
Right. And then, I mean, I've seen pictures of you at like Barnes & Noble and other bookstores and stuff. That's gotta be pretty awesome. Walking into a bookstore and there you are right on the shelf. That's got to be an exciting moment.
Yeah, definitely. Like when I first came out, I went to a bunch of the local Barnes and Nobles, and I went to one of them and I said, oh, I saw on Instagram that you were doing this. We're so excited to have you here. I'm like, you know who I am? And it's
that's awesome. They did an event with you then?
Yeah, I've done a couple of signings at local Barnes and Nobles. Yeah.
Oh, that's awesome.
Successful stuff. Yeah.
So I can imagine that you'll be doing stuff in the spring when book two comes out as well.
Oh yeah, definitely. Yeah. Uh-huh.
Awesome. Awesome. Well, Gama, thanks so much for hanging out with me. Can you please let my listeners know where they can find out more about you online?
Sure. You can find my page at Facebook. It's Gama Ray Martinez. I'm also on GamaRayMartinez.com, and same thing for Twitter. It's at GamaRayMartinez. So, yep.
You made it so easy for everyone. Awesome. Gama, thanks for hanging out with me again. I look forward to seeing you in February again.
All right. Sounds good. All right. Thanks, Mark.
So I want to reflect on two particular things from the interview with Gama. So the first thing is something that he kind of just threw out really quickly, and I want to call your attention to it. And I used it in the opening clip, the opening teaser clip for this episode. What do we call that? Do we call that the cold open? I don't know. What do you call it? What do you call that? I'm getting beside myself. Let me know. What do you call that little? I just call it a teaser or a teaser clip. But he talked about 10 years of going to, and I think he was referring specifically to either going to different conferences or going to Superstars writing seminars to get where he got. He got a deal with Harper Voyager. He got a contract. He pitched book to agent or publisher and got that. But it was 10 years later, 10 years of dedication, 10 years of expensive travel and work and dedication and sweat and blood and tears and all those things to get where he got to. And we often forget those things when we see someone who's found success, and we forget about all the work they put into it, that he stuck it out for 10 years. And he took the courses, he worked on the craft, and he cranked things out. He even talks about going back and going, looking at earlier work, an entire book he wrote that he had just put in a drawer, and then going back to that. So there's all these things, all this work, all these drafts, all of this that folks like Gama have worked on that we never see all that hard work. We only see, oh, wow, dude's got books in Barnes & Noble. He can walk in and see them on the shelf and all of these things. And he sold stories to Dave Farland and these other anthologies and got quotes from Brandon Sanderson. Well, it's not that he just walked into it. It's not that he lucked into it. Sure, luck does always play a factor. But it was a long, tireless effort that he consistently put in that got him to where he is. And so don't forget that. If you're at the beginning of your writing journey, don't forget it took 10 years to get to that point. I've been in the industry for decades. I sold my first short story in 1992, and I'm still getting better in every way. I'm still learning both the craft and the business of writing, even though I've worked in the bookselling and publishing industry for three decades. I'm still learning every single day, as we all are, and we're all growing, we're all getting better in different ways. I just heard from a good friend who's at a craft writers conference, and she was saying she hadn't been to a craft focused conference in a long time, and she's a brilliant writer, absolutely brilliant, really knows her stuff, and she's there learning more about the craft, because we never stop progressing, we never stop learning, we never stop growing. And that second thing that Gama says as well, and again emphasized in the opening teaser, is the critical importance of that first draft. You cannot edit something you have not written. You cannot write the second draft. I'm in the throes of Canadian Mounted and looking at writers like John Hughes, brilliant writer. He was a comedy writer, but, you know, Planes, Trains, and Automobiles, one of my favorite movies. It's a buddy comedy movie. Silly, it's got a lot of funny moments in it, but it makes me cry at the end every single time. I cry at the very end when Neil and his wife are reunited, and Dell's invited into the home and is standing there and just looking at them and gripping his hat. I'm moved to tears every time you go away. You take a piece of me with you. So anyways, back to John Hughes. John Hughes, you know, and he wrote some really poignant moments as well as a lot of great humor. But John Hughes, in the book, and this is kind of related to Gama in the first draft, is John Hughes wrote Planes, Trains, and Automobiles in 3 days. And most of his drafts later on were written between 3 and 5 days on average. And the reason he does that is he just wants to get through it, because he wants to see if he actually likes it. He just wants to get through the whole process, get the first draft. And then he writes 25 to 30 other drafts. I got my hands on numerous drafts of Planes. Well, numerous. I had two drafts of Planes, Trains, and Automobiles that I was using for research for the book, for deleted scenes and stuff like that. And that was two of the 25 to 30 drafts. But even in the final, what's called, I have a copy of the final shooting draft. There's still tons of changes between that draft and the dialogue and the things that happen in the movie. Because as Hughes said in an interview, even when that script is done, he's not done until he's done the final cut and edit of the movie. That things can change and morph all along. And that goes back to that critical importance. You can't do these rewrites. You can't make it better. You can't refine it. You can't have a product to work with unless you've gotten the first draft out. And who cares? Who cares if that first draft is not ready for prime time? That's what it's not for, prime time. That first draft is to get it done, to finish it, to complete it, so you can put it aside, take some distance, come back to it, and then re-attack it and look at it and see what it can be, what can be approved on, what can be taken away, what can be added, etc. So great advice from Gama, a great example of working hard, dedication over the long term. And I hope you, dear listener, found as much inspiration from the interview as I did. If you have your own reflections on that interview, feel free to please leave them over at starkreflections.ca for this episode 269. But that is it for my own reflection. Thank you so much for joining me here. If you like the podcast, I would greatly, greatly appreciate if you could leave a review on whatever platform you happen to listen to podcasts on, or better yet, share it with someone that you think would find value in these stark reflections. So, until next week, or rather it's 2 weeks from when I'm recording this, but to you, dear listener, if you're listening to this the week it comes out, until next week, or the next time you listen to the next episode because of all the time-shifting things that happen in podcast land, this is Mark Leslie Lefebvre wishing you great writing and good stark reflections.
Thank you for listening to the Stark Reflections podcast. You can find show notes for each episode at starkreflections.ca.
The music for this podcast, Laser Groove, was composed and produced by Kevin MacLeod. Check out more of Kevin's great music at incomptech.com.
And I'd like you to meet a friend of mine.
Hello, Mr. Griffith.
Hello, Mrs. P.